Okay, as you can probably tell, I have a pile of motherboard boxes sitting right behind me, and there's a good reason for that. Today marks a day where you can actually buy one of AMD's B550 chipsets. Now, what exactly is a B550 chipset or a B550 motherboard? Well, it's essentially bringing mostly higher-end features found on X570 boards, the more expensive ones, to a more affordable price point. Okay, so this video was originally going to be about B550, but as of this morning, AMD is rolling out a bunch of new processors for their lineup. So that would be the Ryzen 9 3900 XT, the Ryzen 7 3800 XT, and the Ryzen 5 3600 XT. Now, before I get into the specs, do keep in mind that all of these CPUs are using an updated and refined version of AMD's 7-nanometer manufacturing process. So what does that mean? Well, looking at the differences between the Ryzen 9 3900X and the 3900 XT, there really isn't all that much going on here other than a small 100 megahertz increase in the boost frequency. This CPU will be priced at $500, whereas you can find the 3900X for around $420 these days. But what this doesn't show is that all XT versions will supposedly maintain a higher clock speed more consistently and for longer periods of time. According to AMD, that will lead to raw performance increases of about 4%. The 3800 XT follows the same mold, but it gets a boost frequency increase of 200 megahertz and a price of $400. Yeah, that's a pretty big jump since the 3800X is hitting around $330 these days, but don't forget, that CPU was officially launched at $400 as well. Finally, there's the Ryzen 5 3600 XT, and versus the 3600X, it gets a bump of 100 megahertz and a price cut of $250. Another thing to note is that the 3600 XT will be the only one that's going to be shipped with a cooler, whereas AMD recommends an aftermarket cooling solution for the 3900 XT and the 3800 XT. Also, these updated CPUs will start to go on sale on July the 7th. Back to motherboards. Now, before I get too far into this video, I do want to mention something that I'm pretty sure most of you would think is pretty bad news, and that is, AMD doesn't want to replace B450 with B550. They will still be offering B450 motherboards. It's just that B550 is more of a cut-down version of X570. That means most of these new motherboards won't be able to hit the same kind of price point as B450, which is under the $120 price point. As a matter of fact, we're going to start to see a lot of overlap between higher-end B550 motherboards and some X570 boards as well. And honestly, we think that this is going to cause a bit of confusion, so I decided to put together this quick little video to explain B550 and its platform, as well as walk you through some of the motherboard options that will be available out there. Now, about this pile, huge props to ASUS for agreeing to our crazy idea. They essentially sent us their entire B550 stack, so we could do some proper comparisons and see what the new B550 motherboards offer compared to B450 series. Also, if you're interested in any of these motherboards, I'll leave timestamps in the description down below so you can get to them relatively quickly. There are a lot of great things to discuss in this video, but I also have some concerns as well. So let's kick things off by taking a closer look at the B550 chipset and what it brings to the table when it comes to compatibility. Basically, if you have an older processor, you can forget about upgrading to B550 without first upgrading your CPU too. It's only compatible with 3000 series processors and upcoming next generation CPUs based on Zen 3 architecture, but not APUs with processor graphics like the 3000G series. It's also important to note that next generation of desktop CPUs based on Zen 3 are supposed to be the last ones on the AM4 socket. So if you're planning to upgrade in the future, B550 and X570 will likely only be viable for one more CPU generation. At first, AMD tried really hard to push people towards their newer chipsets by blocking Zen 3 compatibility for X470 and B450 motherboards. And as we all know, that caused a major, major outrage. But since we all screamed really loud, certain beta BIOSes for those chipsets allowed next generation support. So what's really new with B550? Well, I guess the obvious thing is PCIe Gen 4 and a few other features. So let's take a closer look. Let's start with the most obvious, and that's the capabilities that come directly from the CPU. Earlier generation Ryzen processors could natively offer the platform 4 5 gigabits per second USB connections and 16 Gen 3 PCI lanes for graphics. There were also 4 Gen 3 lanes dedicated to NVMe storage that could be broken into 2 NVMe lanes and a pair of SATA 3 gigabits per second links. The Ryzen 3000 series CPUs pretty much increase that in every way. Instead of the 4 USB ports operating at 5 gigabits per second, they're able to run at 10 gigabits per second, which is twice the data rate. And then of course, there's the move to PCIe Gen 4. For that, you get 16 graphics lanes that some boards can divide into two 8X links for NVIDIA's SLI or Crossfire, and there's an additional 4 dedicated to NVMe storage. Those can also be separated for either a single X4 NVMe drive, two X2 drives, or a single X2 connection along with SATA. One of the carryovers from B450 is the CPU to chipset interface, which sticks to 4 Gen 3 lanes, whereas boards based on X570 get Gen 4 support. The reason for that is pretty simple. Basically, B550 gets all of its Gen 4 lanes from the CPU, and the chipset doesn't have any itself, so there's no need for a higher bandwidth path between the two. X570, on the other hand, offers a ton of PCIe Gen 4 connections from the chipset. What the chipset offers is the same number of USB connections as B450, but at the top end, there's a pair of native 10 gigabits per second ports. The B550 chipset also offers 6 more flexible PCIe Gen 3 lanes instead of Gen 2, so there's more possibility of seeing higher bandwidth features like Wi-Fi 6 added to these new motherboards. Meanwhile, the possibility of SATA connections stay pretty much unchanged. What this all leads to is actually a serious problem for Intel. On many levels, these B550 motherboards offer a very similar feature set to Z490 while also including overclocking and PCIe Gen 4. So that's an overview of what you can expect from B550. But just like any other motherboard, there is a pretty big catch. You see, everyone needs to remember that it is ultimately up to the motherboard manufacturer to implement the full extent of B550 features. In order to save money and offer different products at separate price points, a lot of these features do tend to get cut down on lower-end boards. So that could mean that a higher-end B550 motherboard could end up offering more connectivity options than a mid-tier or a mid-range X570 board. Just think about that for a sec. So I guess this makes for a perfect introduction into the ASUS lineup. Now, I do need to repeat this one more time, and that is, generally B550 motherboards are much more expensive compared to B450. And the reason for that is PCIe Gen 4 signaling requires upgraded PCBs. And it's not only that, a lot of these motherboard manufacturers are packing these boards with features like upgraded VRMs, more heat sinks to support higher core count CPUs, 2.5G LAN, Wi-Fi 6, and a bunch of other stuff. I wanted to get things kicked off with the lower end Prime series, since their prices have increased the least from B450. But that means there's less new features added as well. Basically, there's an uptake of $20 to $25, and there's a new B550MA board that includes a Wi-Fi 6 module. In this price range, the mATX form factor is really popular since it cuts down on price without killing off too many features. The B550MK is pretty typical of what you'd normally find in an entry-level board, but it isn't something that I'd want to run a Ryzen 9 CPU on. But it does have PCIe Gen 4 compatibility for a GPU and a single 4-lane M.2 slot. Those two items give some good future upgrade options. On the other hand, the Prime B550MA is supposed to be the sweet spot, but to be honest with you, I'd expect a bit more from a $135 motherboard. It actually looks a lot like the K, with the only additions being an expanded VRM design with heatsinks, two Aura RGB headers, and a single addressable RGB header. The one that I have here has an optional Wi-Fi 6 module, which adds about $15 to the price. Personally, I'd gladly pay a small premium for a Wi-Fi enabled motherboard, but that's just me. Stepping things up, and we're out of the mATX boards to the full-size ATX B550 Plus that's supposed to go for $150 US. It has all the features from the smaller ones, but there's also a Thunderbolt 3 header, a USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-C on the backplate, and a second full-length M.2 slot. Just make note that like all of these B550 motherboards, only the top M.2 slot uses a high-speed Gen 4 connection, while the lower one has PCIe Gen 3 and SATA support. Speaking of Gen 3, that second X16 PCI slot uses 4 Gen 3 lanes from the chipset, while the top slot gets the CPU's 16 Gen 4 lanes. Oh, and the B550 Plus doesn't have Wi-Fi either. Moving on to the B550 Tough series, and now is when we're starting to see some major price increases versus previous gen. Just so you know, I added the B450 Pros to the list since the new Plus series have features that align more with those than the B450 Pluses. Either way, I think these motherboards will be a good balance for price versus compatibilities. They aren't as expensive as the ROG products, but they also offer more features, better overclocking, and a lot of other upgrades when compared to the Prime series. I actually really like the look of these new tough motherboards, especially in the smaller, more compact MATX format like the B550M+. It has an 8+2 stage Dr. Mohs power design that's covered in massive heat sinks, one PCI Gen 4 X16 slot, and an X4 Gen 3 slot along with a single X1 connector. The M.2 area is interesting, but in an odd way. Even though PCI Gen 4 drives tend to run hotter than other NVMe SSDs, the top M.2 area with its Gen 4 connection doesn't have a heatsink, while the lower one does. Compared to the Prime series, tough boards also have an upgraded PCB with a 2-ounce copper layer, a better Realtek audio controller, 2.5G LAN, a handy BIOS flashback button, and in general, just more connectivity. The sample that I have here is the B550M Plus Wi-Fi, which is identical to the standard Plus, but it has Wi-Fi 6, and as usual, you'll need to pay a bit more for that. The tough B550 Plus is essentially a copy and paste of the MATX board, but in a larger ATX spec. The only real changes are a longer M.2 slot, 6 SATA connectors instead of 4, a key M.2 slot for ASUS's optional Wi-Fi module, and 2 more X1 PCI slots. And finally, we've come to the ROG Strix series, and these guys are starting to get expensive, but even the flagship B550E barely reaches a mid-level X570 price. So for some people who want tons of features without going X570, a higher-end B550 motherboard might be the way to go. Sometimes. I mean, maybe. Another thing I need to highlight is the premium for Wi-Fi is $20 here, even though both B550F boards are otherwise identical. You'll also notice a lack of MATX options here and the only ITX B550 motherboard that ASUS will be offering at launch. That's really too bad since it seems like ITX is now being considered a premium form factor for a lot of motherboard companies these days. But let's start with that one and see what you can get for $230. Well, the Strix B550i is just jam-packed with absolutely everything ASUS could possibly fit into a smaller form factor. It has an 8+2 phase PWM design that's actively cooled by a fan, and it also is the only motherboard in the entire lineup that supports memory speeds up to 5100 MHz. For connectivity, you name it, and this board has it, other than Thunderbolt, that is. The larger boards do have a Thunderbolt header for an optional add-in card, but either way, there's Wi-Fi 6, an Intel 2.5G LAN port, plenty of USB 3.2 Gen 2 connectors, and a built-in I/O shield. The board's back is also pretty straightforward, but it's where the additional M.2 slot sits. Now, moving on to the B550F, this is the lowest priced ROG board, and I have to wonder if this thing will cut into some of ASUS's X570 sales. It gets a lot of the ITX features like 2.5G LAN, plus there's a 12+2 phase power section that's fed with an 8+4 pin connection, a Thunderbolt header, and unlike the tough boards, both M.2 slots get heatsinks. These are all huge upgrades over the B450F motherboard, but you also can't forget that they've pushed this thing's price by a good $60, or if you add Wi-Fi, by $80. Finally, we've got the king of the hill, the Strix B550E. Think of this like B550F on steroids. It has every feature that I've talked about up to now, with the addition of splittable Gen 4 GPU lanes, so you can run Crossfire or SLI in a x8x8 mode. This is also the only board in ASUS's B550 lineup that has a Q-code debug LED, a 14+2 power architecture, and Wi-Fi that you don't technically have to pay extra for. With this motherboard, you'll need to seriously ask yourself if you need to pay extra for an X570 with the same feature set or whether B550 is enough. From the way I see it, the B550E has more than most people would ever need in a motherboard. So that's it. While B550 isn't necessarily replacing B450 like everyone was hoping for, it certainly complements those cheaper products. Now, I should also mention that this is an interesting platform that bridges the gap with X570. I mean, in some cases, I do wonder if some of these new B550 motherboards end up giving entry-level X570 boards a run for its money. Not only that, it's also really difficult to spending money on a Comet Lake and a Z490 motherboard because it's just really hard to justify spending that much. Either way, I'm excited for this new platform. I'm actually looking forward to working on some budget-focused builds. And if you're in the market, looking around to build a new PC, would you consider going B550? Curious to know. Thank you so much for watching. I'll talk to you guys in the next one.